I cannot wait. The rematch, it is finally here, ladies and gentlemen. Deontay Wilder and Tyson Fury will lock horns for the second time at the this time at the MGM Grand Garden Arena. Brian Campbell, you will be there. Brian, first of all, before I get to the question that we have listed here, what would you say your level of enthusiasm is? Because the press tour for this, granted, it's the second time. I mean, how many times can you call a guy a dosser before you get a little bit tired of it? But it feels my enthusiasm for it is high because of what it all could mean. But in terms of, I think, what I read in the public, I do think it's going to sell well because this stuff just builds late. It doesn't have quite the same feel as the first one.
No, it doesn't. And you're asking me, well, am I excited about it? Yeah, right now I am dialed in. I'm freaking fired up. But it was a late, slow build. It's not a bad thing, though. Because what Tyson Fury didn't do this time around was be Tyson Fury, be the crazy guy in the buildup, go Dosser like crazy. In fact, there was no real acrimony between the two. There was no heated face-to-faces that ended in a shove. There was barely a press tour. But you know what it was about, Luke?
Mm.
All the storylines building up to this was about real things that actually affect the fight. Tyson Fury changing trainers at the last minute, changing philosophy and strategy at the last minute, all that stuff.
Mm.
So now, why am I excited about this fight? I'm excited because of the historical context and how important it is, the fact that the winner's probably in control as your sort of pound-for-pound best heavyweight in the moment and would have the lineal title, depending on what you feel about that. I'm personally a lineal guy. I think that's the true currency in the sport. But I'm actually more excited about it, not from the two personalities, from what the fight will look like, which in theory, Luke, especially for the hardcores, that's why you should be excited about it. This doesn't have the type of commercial catnip that we had the first time around in terms of like Tyson Fury's here in America. He's throwing, you know, he's here. He's going to put it out there. Oh, Dosser, all this, you know, mental health comeback, all that great stuff. That's to attract and pull in the casuals. We may be lacking on that, but we have a much more intriguing storyline about the actual fight than we did the first time around, because you have to remember the questions coming in about Tyson Fury after that layoff, after getting two soft comeback fights and going in there. Now we know who both guys are. Now we know the success that each of them had in the first fight, and now it's sort of like which style is going to work better. I'm fired the heck up for the right reasons in the end.
And also, I would argue before I pitch the first question to you, I would just make a case that given what we know about Deontay and his style, given what we know about Tyson and his style, we'll see what kind of strategy he employs ultimately. It's actually a time to reflect on the nature of heavyweight boxing, the state of the current division, its past, its future. It's actually a pretty cool, interesting moment.
When was the last time we had a title rematch between unbeaten guys? I mean, probably never, because it's so rare to have a draw in the first fight and then come back to a high-level rematch. But think of how rare this is. They're both at the very top of their game. They both have a legitimate title to bring into place. Deontay WBC, the lineal belt for Fury, the idea of control of this division potentially and what could happen if they can ever make a Joshua payday. And the whole idea of, are they going to do it again? We know that there's language in the contract that would say the loser has the right to activate a rematch clause at the 60-40 money split. So we could be seeing two of these fights this year. Look, there is some legitimate history here coming off of that horrifically bad heavyweight era. We had like that Joshua Klitschko fight that kind of kicked it into gear through the Wilder Fury fight in December 2018, and now we get to see it again. This is going to be a hellacious fight because there's so much at stake. Deontay can end it at any time, and Tyson Fury just might be the heavyweight of this era. This is crazy.
All right, so given those considerations, let's play a little bit of a game here. We decided we were going to basically flip a coin and say, make a case for either fighter. You would like to make the case for Tyson Fury. I'll play the opposite. I'll make the case for Deontay Wilder, even though I'm not sure if he actually can win, but I will be his lawyer in this court.
Can he win? He can beat anybody with one punch at any time.
But you know what I'm trying to say. In terms of like what I think is a probabilistic outcome, not whether it is a possible one. So with that being said, make the case for Tyson Fury. Why does he win this rematch on Saturday?
Well, here's what's interesting about it. Here's where it gets juicy. Here's where the biggest theme coming into this fight is so sort of like, I don't know where to go right now. Nobody changes trainers 2 months out from the biggest fight of their career, right? Ben Davison, the 25-year-old guy who was sort of like a best friend, buddy, instrumental in sort of helping Fury develop that defensive style that kind of won him the first fight, depending on how you scored it. And really emotionally, a guy who helped him sort of overcome his demons, come back from all that he did in that miraculous story that he had. That guy's gone. He's going now to Sugar Hill Steward, the nephew of Emmanuel Steward, the late Hall of Famer, Kronk Jim, with the idea of, I left something on the table in the first fight, meaning he left it to the judge's hands. He didn't know his full stamina ability at that point, if he can go 12 rounds, if he could have Wilder hurt and try to step in there and finish him.
Twice.
Wow. So the idea that Fury at every stop on this build has said, I am going for the knockout, I'm learning the Kronk way so I can sit down on my punches, is insanely intriguing, Luke. From the idea of that, this is going to be a more exciting fight. But Is it crazy, though, is the question.
Let me just ask you a question. You believe him when he says that? Because I don't.
I didn't at first, but doubling down on it, tripling down on it, me on a conference call just the other day, really asking him about it, talking to his trainer and asking him about it, yes, I actually think. Do I think he's going to recklessly go out and try to brawl? No. I do think there's an interesting avenue to have success. You remember his last fight against Otto Wallin? Supposed to be a walkthrough, right? Tyson Fury gets the vicious cut early in the fight. Has to essentially go into crazy man mode because that fight could be stopped at any point and he loses his title because of the cut. So what did he do? He used his 6'9" size, leaned all over Wallin, brawled on the inside, did a lot of shifting, but it was all power punches all the way. He was trying to get a stoppage. I think Tyson Fury remembered something when he went through that. That this is kind of more of the style he employed early on in his career. And his dad, Big John Fury, has been talking for years about Tyson needs to be bigger, he needs to be 270 pounds, he needs to come in with that weight. Very few fighters historically in the heavyweight division, Luke, can fight well on the inside. Remember when Riddick Bowe was like this dream, the 6'5" guy with quick hands who can do it on the inside? Deontay Wilder is still this raw guy who needs to set up his right hand and use the jab to do it. What if Fury is thinking, I'm the bigger guy, I weigh more, I'm the more skilled guy, where the first fight he did his best to avoid the big right hand, what if now he tries to smother it and get inside? You're thinking, wow, this is a crazy strategy. You know what's a crazy strategy? Trying to go 12 full rounds against Deontay Wilder at any point. Look, he almost got his head knocked off in the 12th round after basically pitching a perfect game to get there. Maybe it's not so crazy to hear Tyson Fury's reasoning and say, the judges took this fight away from me for the first time around. I can't get a decision in the States. I know what I'm up against. I'm going to put it into my hands and try to win it. I know the knee-jerk reaction is, well, you're not a power puncher. It's proven it. You don't have that. But if you go back and watch that first fight, I know both fighters dispute this. It looked like Wilder was hurt on two occasions.
The first round.
And also in the 12th round.
Yep.
And Fury is saying, I didn't believe in my stamina enough to try to finish him. Here's what you have to ask yourself. Is Fury the best fighter of this heavyweight group? Is he everything he says he is? Is he just a con man, or is he everything he says he is? So what is he? He's a fighting man, right? In his lineage that goes back to bare-knuckle champions for generations. Luke, there's a magic inside of him that we rarely see in sports, right? We talk about that a lot with Conor McGregor, where he was just calling his shot and winning fights. We certainly had that with Muhammad Ali, who built up this sort of idealism in the 70s that he could win a fight no matter what because of these sort of hero type of moments. Rope-a-dope against George Foreman in Zaire. For Tyson Fury to pull this off in this rematch against Wilder and do what he says, which is go in there and fight and actually stop him, would be a modern-day Rumble in the Jungle. And as crazy as it sounds, if anyone can do it, it's actually him, Luke. It's actually a 6'9" guy with a rare speed, length, better boxing ability than his opponent, and what we've seen from him outside the ring and inside the ring, an ability to bite down and get the job done and find a way to win that's really incomparable in this era. Yes, Deontay Wilder could finish him at any point in any fight. If they fought 10 times, he may finish 9 of them by knockout. But I actually believe Tyson Fury is going to carry out this game plan. And with this type of trainer, with the Kronk style, and seeing what he could be as a fighter on the inside, use his weight, it may be a boring fight because of that. It may be a yuck fest because of that. But I think he can win this fight, and I actually think he can stop him.
So that was a moderately compelling case for a boxer who deserved better than what you offered to him just now. I'm teasing. I actually think that here's what we know to be sure. Clearly Tyson Fury is the better boxer, right? Who's going to be the better fighter in the end, which is more than just boxing ability?
That's what we're going to find out in this fight.
That's right, exactly correct. But we both agree that the better boxer, by far, is Tyson Fury. So Tyson Fury is going to outbox him until the fight either expires or I don't think he's going to stop Deontay. You can tell me what you want, but I just don't believe that. Or Deontay knocks him out. Really the only one of two possibilities. I thought he won the first time, but okay, he didn't. Here we are. What is the best case for Deontay Wilder? Well, it's almost his worst case. It's almost his reality, which is to say, we have a debate about who are the best power punchers of all time. George Foreman has even said Deontay Wilder is certainly at the top of that list or right near it. And I would agree, but he's not an Ernie Shavers. He doesn't have power in all circumstances, right? He has some power with that left hook, but it's usually after the right straight, right? It's usually in combination, like the one he dropped Tyson Fury with in the 12th round. But by itself, the left hook, it's powerful, but it's not game-changing. Even then, does Deontay Wilder have a good uppercut? Not really. I mean, a little bit.
He doesn't have what Lennox Lewis had to be able to take guys out with.
Absolutely. So where does Deontay Wilder's power typically come from? It's a right straight. It's a right straight. He doesn't have power in all those circumstances. Now, in that right straight category, you're talking about an all-time puncher. an all-time puncher.
Doesn't need a full extension, doesn't need a setup, just can get you out of there.
I mean, again, no lack of full, he didn't have full extension in the second Ortiz fight. Look what happened there. He had him doing, you know, he had him, well, I didn't want to get into it. But the point being is this. So what could be the case for him now that I'm saying all these negative things about him? The reality is he cannot outbox Tyson Fury. And I do think, I agree a little bit, that one strategy you could implement, which I think is just a version of what he did the first time, slightly amended, is, and we'll get to it on Dissected this week, is occupying that right side. Because to the extent that the right side has to get defensive, or he can't simply use it because it's being smothered, Ortiz, even from the southpaw position, kind of smothered the angle. Yeah, that works. That actually is absolutely effective. Hanging on him, I'm less convinced about. But okay. It also is an opportunity for Deontay Wilder. Deontay Wilder, I argue, much like Dominic Reyes against John Jones, Dominic Reyes, what do we say about him? He's not that good at setting traps offensively. He's good at creating them, backing up. Deontay Wilder has knocked out so many guys, not backing into the ropes, but kind of angling backwards and then waiting, and then popping them. So to me, if he's playing the matador against this bull, against Tyson Fury, not to say Tyson Fury is not the better boxer, because he is, not even saying Tyson Fury won't win that way, but to me that raises the chances of, one, Deontay Wilder. Secondly, what I would say is, if he does have to be the bull and not the matador, we're not talking about having to set a ton of traps, Brian Campbell. For example, what is one of the punches he's really good at? He's good at left hooks to the body. He's good at jabs to the body. In fact, some of the punches that he ends up landing on Luis Ortiz in the second fight, you can see Ortiz go to down parry, and then the punch comes and drills him right in the face. So it's about all he has to do is a little bit more than he did the first time. If you go back and you look at Deontay Wilder in the first fight, dude, he didn't do a good job. He had hardly any feints. He had hardly any shot diversification. It was a lot of from far distance, throw a jab and then a cross over the top. Well, you mean to tell me if you can add just a couple of feints and you can use that to back Fury up against the ropes, and then from there you can begin to unload on him a little bit and you can go to hit the jab to the body? All I'm saying is you don't have to be somebody you're not. Give me a little bit of offensive trickery, a few feints, some shots to the body, some left hooks to the body, and then eventually, your right is so powerful, this is why he finds the shot later in fights.
His power never fades.
It never fades, and he's not that good at setting traps, yeah. So he has to wait until they get comfortable. Luis Ortiz in the seventh round got comfortable. You even saw...
Well, and you got to give Wilder credit. His stamina compared to this heavyweight era
is very good.
Insane.
It's very good. I mean, to carry power the way he did in the 12th round, is you haven't seen that in a long time. So my point about this is, in terms of finding Fury, dude, when he says Fury has to be perfect for 12 rounds, he's right, dude. People can say whatever they want. He is right. You mean to tell me there's not going to be a time where he gets the stance of Fury to be squared, to lean against the ropes, to turn the wrong way, especially if he's looking for the knockout? Dude, that's a terrible strategy.
Here's the thing, though. What's the alternative for Tyson Fury? Go out and try to outbox him again and try
He boxed him the first time.
Right. Try to walk that slippery slope and hope again that the judges reward you for what you did. Either way is a sort of suicide mission. Either way, you're going to have to go up close to the fire and get burned, because Deontay Wilder, whatever you think about him, is a special heavyweight in this era who, like we talk about, can end a fight at any time. But there's really only one man, I believe, who can snuff that. You have to have size, you have to have speed, you have to have technique, and you have to have the crazy like a fox. Fury is going to be willing to walk that tightrope, Luke, like no one else, and have the attributes to potentially pull this off. Is it likely he gets a knockout? No. We've also never really seen Deontay Wilder have to fight backing up for a long, sustained period. Mm. He usually has such a threat where even when he touches you partially, guys sort of change their ways, rightfully so.
You go look at the first fight. Where did Tyson Fury have the most success in the first fight?
He circled away. He took away the jab.
Where did he have the most success in the first fight? Towards the center. Even against the ropes, there were times when Deontay is not good at setting traps. You know what he is pretty good at? When he wants to be, he can kind of cut off the ring very quickly. There are times, remember Luis Ortiz? Luis Ortiz was the one who was pushing into him, Deontay on the ropes in the back. What did Deontay do? Just circled right around and then shut his lights off. A couple times that happened to Fury the first time as well. Fury needs to keep that in the center. Now, you can smother there. That's possible. I think another thing is you know, getting low and then driving into him and then closing the gap. Now, it brings into questions about that cut. That's another X factor we should sort of consider. But I'm just pointing out, to me, it's like Deontay Wilder has to do what he did the first time, only polished. For Tyson Fury to do the Tiger Woods bit where you're just going to reinvent your swing, you're not going to win your first tournament reinventing your swing.
It's a fair point. Look, look, the smart money here, if you're a betting man, the smart money is Deontay Wilder across the board, even though Fury is a slight favorite in most books.
I actually favor Fury to win. I'm just making the case for Deontay Wilder.
You know, after that first press conference, I thought a Wilder knockout was undoubtedly this case because he's so dialed in. He did not allow Fury to get in his head in this build like he did the first time around. I don't think he's going to have the same problem that Wilder admittedly had in that first fight where the moment got too big for him. He really wasn't himself. He wasn't relaxed. But here's the thing, though, Luke. When have you ever seen Deontay Wilder in an extended brawl? Never. Okay? When he gets most wild is when he has an opponent hurt. Maybe in Fury's mind, I've got the better technique. I know I have the balls to try this. What if I can get him into chaos? Typically, Deontay Wilder dominates in chaos because he's got the helicopter craziness and he just catches you. What if Fury, who we know is comfortable in chaos in all forms, is thinking if I could keep him off tilt, rather than just having him wait back and let me outbox him and just wait for his moment with the right hand, what if I can get him into craziness? Can I catch his wild technique and catch him on the chin at the wrong angle
and
hurt him?
Which he did in the first round.
I'm saying the entertainment potential in this fight is double from the first time around. It's not just, you know, strikeout pitcher against home run hitter. I think it's going to be a little bit more crazier. And if anyone can do this impossible task, Luke, it actually is Tyson Fury. I do think he's special. I do think he is the heavyweight of this era. He very well may get knocked out on Saturday night and that may change the course or produce the need for a third fight. But as crazy as this is, I think he can do it.
I don't think Berman Stavern is Tyson Fury, and I don't think Luis Ortiz is Tyson Fury. But those are the two rematches that Deontay Wilder had. Not only did he win him, he won him much quicker the second time around. Just want to point that out. I'll just go to you on this one. I won't even answer. There's no big sports on Saturday night. There's no big UFC. There's some Auckland. We'll get to that in a second. But there's no pay-per-view. There's no college sports of any significance. There might be some basketball, but basketball sucks for college. There might be some NBA. There's no real big thing on the sporting calendar. Plus, you've got ESPN and Fox coming together for this pay-per-view.
Before at this level.
Give me a sense of what you think. To me, it's like a perfect time to see, wow, how big can a boxing pay-per-view be in 2020?
You know, we did mention it doesn't have the viral moments on the build, right? The big near brawl at a press conference or something that just sticks to you. But they have had the advertisement of that first fight. And, you know, showing the highlights of Tyson Fury getting dropped in the 12th round and getting back up sells itself. I always thought the ceiling could have been 1.5 million pay-per-view buys under how we used to track them, right? I think we're looking at least a million, no question. You have to consider it did, 300,000 the first time around, which was different scenario, different circumstances.
Yeah. Tyson Fury's breakout moment, essentially.
I mean, he's been in WWE. He's been in breakout in these two machines pushing them. I think it could do 1.3, 1.4, and that would be a huge victory for all of them because at the end of the day, you do have two heavyweights who can talk, who have very distinctive, fun styles, and you have that ability to sell the rematch off of those highlights. We haven't had the sort of circus WWE stuff that we thought, but I think it's going to be a late build because you have to see what happens. You have to. Heavyweights are starting, they're back. They matter right now, and this fight is so pivotal to what happens next.